ones. We're good.
You're good to go.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning. Good morning.
How are we doing today? Good. We're about halfway already, at least through the material that I've got. But yeah, I've had halfway through that week as well. So, just a little recap of what we've got up to. We've been asking this question of can music mean anything? And we started looking at modernism's answer, which would translate, I think, into postmodernism's answer, at least in its essential elements. And then, of course, yesterday we started to backtrack and we went to the 18th century and looked at historical attitudes to this question of whether music can mean anything, and if so, what it can, and what stories can music tell. And I hope I was able to show you that what we saw in the sessions, in our last couple of sessions now, with those examples of Vivaldi and Bach, with representation, symbolism, and then, of course, yesterday with Mozart, and looking at this subject of topic, where Mozart really utilizes brilliantly the associations we make between sounds, in his case, dance forms, and extra musical meaning and significance and so on. And I want you to keep, all of that in mind, but especially what we saw in the first session on topic, which was that Mozart one. You can see this session I've called Meaning and Topic 2. So it really is a continuation of what we were looking at in that session yesterday, and you can see they're beyond dance forms. So that gives you a little hint of where we're going to go today as we look at Beethoven and revolution. But before I pitch in, can I just pray and ask the Lord to help us? Father, we bless you. Father, we worship you. Father, we love you. Mm-hmm. We love you for so many reasons. We love you because you first loved us and sent your Son, Christ Jesus, to die for us, to die for our sins, to bring us to yourself. He is raised to life for our life, and he is our life. And because of him, we can enjoy all of life that you have given us in your wonderful creation. This world is fallen, and yet we have so much beauty. And Father, as we look at just one tiny aspect of beauty in your creation, again today, Father, we pray that our hearts would thrill, not just at the genius of humanity, men and women, and these incredible talents that we meet in history, but our hearts would thrill that you are the God who must be so much more beautiful. And Father, we pray that we would see you behind all the beauty we see in your world. Help us, we pray. Give us minds that are able to engage and think clearly about life in your world. Help us, we pray. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. So as the 18th century draws to a close, and the 19th century begins, the musical landscape begins to be dominated by the figure of this gentleman here, Ludwig van Beethoven. Beethoven was born in 1770, and he died in 1827, so he lived almost equal parts of his life in each century, which somehow seems very appropriate. Music historians have argued for a long time about whether Beethoven was the last of the classical composers of, you know, Mozart and Haydn, or whether he was the first of the romantics of the new movement in the 19th century, or whether he was indeed both. I'm not sure that's a very fruitful argument, frankly. The brilliant 18th century music historian and eminent Beethoven scholar, David Wynne Jones — I had the privilege of studying under David Wynne Jones, he's a fantastic scholar of particularly of this period of music. He described Beethoven's contribution in terms of tennis. Is anybody here, you know, tennis fan? I love tennis. I love watching it. I'm a terrible player. But if you imagine a tennis match, a good player is generally hitting his or her shot as close to the lines of the court as they possibly can without going out of them. Yeah. And this, says David Wynne-Jones, is what Beethoven is doing in a sense. He doesn't really shake off the conventions of the classical period entirely. And you could maybe argue that he does that in his final years, but he's hitting the ball as close to the lines as one can imagine without smashing his shots out of court altogether. He's making the court bigger, as the tennis players would say, stretching things as far as they can go without, you know, going out of bounds. And this is a helpful analogy for various reasons, not least because it helps us understand why this perennial argument about Beethoven as the final classicist or the first romantic never really gets settled. But what does this mean for our purposes this week and for our examination of music and meaning? Well, one of the many ways in which we see Beethoven expanding and stretching the conventions of the classical period is in this area of topic that we looked at yesterday. We saw in that last session, didn't we, how Mozart used topic, especially dance forms, with all their complex associations of social structure and so on. In keeping with the times he was living in, Beethoven was living in the age of revolutions. Beethoven seems to be just as interested in dance, but perhaps less interested in hierarchical structures, social structures. He was, after all, the man who said to a wealthy patron who liked to, you know, pay Beethoven to compose, "What you are by accident of birth. What I am by myself. There are and will be 1,000 princes. There is only one Beethoven." What a fabulous quote. I mean, you know, I don't think it's great theology, autonomy and pride. But that really captures a spirit of the age. It's impossible, really, to imagine Mozart saying that to a patron. It's impossible to imagine Haydn saying that, but the world Beethoven inhabits is significantly different. And we see Beethoven especially, you know, if you learn and read about his life, we now see the artist beginning to move between social hierarchies. He is freer to move in sort of aristocratic circles as well as his own. It's not quite social mobility, but there's a more social flexibility going on here. And this is the age of revolutions. The French Revolution has happened. Europe is changing and social structures are changing dramatically. This is a world away from the Marriage of Figaro that we saw yesterday. Maybe it was a kind of world that Figaro was dreaming of. And Beethoven is an innovator, which whatever way you look at Beethoven, you can come at this from so many different angles of Beethoven's innovations. And just one of those innovations, I would argue, that Beethoven brings is the development of this use of topic, of rhythmic gesture, perhaps better put, which seems to possess a fresh and a more immediate meaning, with an astonishing power of expression. Beethoven takes rhythmic gesture and seems able to infuse it with meaning in the moment for very, very expressive purposes. To illustrate this, let's listen to probably, I'm guessing, the most famous piece of Beethoven. This is the first movement from his Fifth Symphony. I don't know how much of this to play, because once it gets going, it's very hard to stop. So forgive me if I just can't bring myself to click pause here, but let's see how we get on. I expect you recognize this. Boom. It's, you know, many, many people have heard, you know, sound of revolution in that music. It was premiered in 1808. You could see they're probably written as early as 1805, 1806. So 15 years within the death of Mozart. Impossible to imagine that music written by Mozart. Anton Schindler, friend of Beethoven and his first biographer, quotes Beethoven as describing this music as, "Thus fate knocks at the door." Now, Schindler's proven to have falsified a whole load of stuff, of conversations and so on with Beethoven, but he didn't necessarily lie all the time. And whether or not Beethoven actually said that, "Thus fate hammers at the door or knocks at the door," this is consistent with what we know about Beethoven's predilection with fate. After all, this was a composer who was struck with deafness and who continued to write his greatest music afterwards. The artist's struggle with life, with the curveballs that fate throws at him or her, was to become a real dominant image in the later 19th century with full-blown romanticism. So whether or not it is fate hammering at the door, in what we've just heard, you probably noticed how that simple, accessible, easily identifiable rhythmic gesture, da-da-da-da, is almost ubiquitous. There's hardly a bar that goes by in that movement that does not have da-da-da-da. And that forms the basis for the material of the following movements as well. Beethoven loves this idea of taking a simple rhythmic idea and you transforming it in such ways that I don't think it ever gets repetitive. You know, I don't know, maybe you were bored in that, but I never get bored in that. And yet it's the same rhythm incessantly. But Beethoven is putting it through such incredible transformation that it takes on new colours and even new meanings. And if we were to listen through the whole symphony, you would hear how that struggle and that kind of earthy, primeval kind of feature here in this first movement is transformed into glorious light in the last movement. But we don't have time to unpack that now. Let's tear ourselves away from the Fifth Symphony to another work which was premiered on the same night in December 1808. In fact, it's a work Beethoven was working on at the same time as the Fifth Symphony, which I find very, very interesting. The sketches, kind of Beethoven sketchbooks, move between these two pieces. Because it's a very, very different work, even though Beethoven was working on it simultaneously. And this is his Sixth Symphony, the Pastoral Symphony. And this is where we want to get our ears, really want to prick up when we're thinking about music and meaning. Beethoven loved nature and he loved the countryside and often took the opportunity to escape the city to enjoy the countryside. And his visits really inspired him to write this symphony, which is full of rural and natural imagery. If we think back to the Four Seasons that we saw day before yesterday, I think, wasn't it? There's nothing unusual about what Vivaldi did or even what Beethoven does here in providing a program, in giving us some little titles for what he is depicting in the music. This is representation again, isn't it? Beethoven subtitled each of the five movements, interestingly. A symphony of this period would usually be four. He gives us five, and subtitled them with a little textual explanation of what he was painting in sound. So here are the titles, and just look at these, because this in itself is interesting before we get to the music. The first movement is the awakening of pleasant feelings on arriving in the countryside. The second movement is the scene at the brook. Excuse me. The third movement, the merry gathering of the peasants. Fourth movement, thunder, storm. And then finally, the shepherd's hymn of thanksgiving after the storm.
Now, I find this fascinating. Before we've listened to a note of music, look at closely at what we've got here. Because this is both like Vivaldi and this is unlike Vivaldi at the same time. We've got elements of direct description, of direct representation here. The scene by the brook, the gathering of the peasants, the depiction of the thunderstorm. This is all rather in tune with that representation of the four seasons and so on that we saw. But then looking closely at Title I, we've got here the awakening of pleasant feelings. This is not something Vivaldi would be likely to do. Might be implied. But this is a description of the feelings evoked by arriving in the countryside. There's a subtle but significant difference now. Rather than trying to paint the rural landscape, Beethoven attempts to represent the inward landscape of his own feelings. Now this is going to become a big deal in full-blown romanticism later in the century. This is quite a departure. The individual response is put up front, first movement, and center stage. The artist puts himself in the picture, almost. And this is an idea, as I say, that will grow up and flourish with full-blown romanticism, and we'll see that in a later session. Let's have a listen to a chunk of this first movement. I won't get through the whole thing. Bear in mind what we've just heard, though, with that idea of the rhythmic cell, almost, you know, that the Beethoven subjects to all those transformations. Keep that in mind. It's a very different piece of music now. But just bear that in mind. And this is... See what you think. This is the awakening of pleasant feelings. There's certainly some representation in it. I'm sure you'll notice some little hints of birdsong and so on. But remember, Beethoven wants the focus of this movement to fall on the awakening of pleasant feeling of the inward landscape. So let's give this a try. Thank you. you hear that the same sort of process going on there? There's a little rhythmic figure. Da 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 da. Almost ubiquitous again. And it's almost as though this is just, do you see how that might relate to pleasant feelings? It's just that sense of, oh goodness, you know, I'm coming alive. Almost the heart skipping a beat to see this beautiful scenery. You can imagine Beethoven, you're the creative person, you're getting out of the dirty city, getting into the country. We all feel like this, don't we? But something about us just gets excited when we see some beautiful landscape. And it's all done, it's not done with topic now, but there's a very strong rhythmic gesture. And of course, in the moment, you can grab all of that. And then as you listen, you know, sometimes Beethoven doubles the speed. Instead of da-da-da-da, you get da-da-da-da-da-da. But it's the same thing, it's just faster, slower, and so on. All the time. It's very accessible, it's very easy to get hold of, it's very easy to understand, even on a first listening, even on that first night in a cold theatre in Vienna in December 1808. You can grab hold of something and know what you're hearing. Beethoven loved this idea of transformation, of simple rhythmic gestures. Now we don't have time to sample some of the more direct representation. It's not we're going to miss out the second and third movements, not because they're not very good, but because we've seen representation in Vivaldi. I would recommend you go and listen to these charming movements. If we had time, we'd go to the slow movement, the scene by the brook, and have a laze around by a stream. And that would finish with a wonderful depiction of birdsong right at the end in the coda of that movement. But we don't have time, I'm sorry, just I'll give you some homework to go and listen to that. And the third movement, we would, if we had time, we would go and hang out with the peasants who are having a lovely meetup. And they're having a lovely dance and probably quaffing a little bit of wine as well. But we don't have time for that stuff because I really want us to focus now on the fourth and fifth movements. They're joined together, but normally in a performance they would run straight through. We're going to have a little hiatus because I'm going to have to push the clicker here. I'll do that as quickly and as smoothly as I can. Now, if we were feeling a little soporific after lazing about by a stream and by enjoying a glass of country wine, Beethoven's about to wake us up because there's a storm on the way. And the question many historians, musicologists have had over the years now, is this a painting purely of the external landscape? We've seen already that Beethoven's got elements of that. He's also, by his own confession, given us elements of the internal landscape, the awakening of pleasant feelings. Is this storm purely situated out there in the sky? And the falling rain and the lightning, you'll certainly get plenty of that, you'll hear it in the music. Or is there also this storm, the turmoil of the inner world of the artist? An artist who's profoundly deaf, by the way, for this point. And how do you carry that burden around with you as Beethoven? Anyway, I don't know if we'll ever answer that, but it's an interesting question to just put out there. So I'm gonna try and run the fourth and the fifth movements. What you'll notice after that is that we get the Shepherd's Hymn of Thanksgiving after the storm. So I think you'll be pretty clear when we run from one to the other. So we're gonna take about 12 minutes or so to get through these two movements. So sit back, relax, and see what you make of, this is the conclusion really, the last two movements of the Sixth Symphony.
Thank you. Thank you.
this stuff. I consider that music is, by its very nature, essentially powerless to express anything at all, whether a feeling, an attitude of mind, a psychological mood, a phenomenon of nature. Expression has never been an inherent property of music. This is what Stravinsky said in 1935. It's extraordinary, isn't it? I've mentioned it already. I don't know, you know, what you thought of that music, but I hope you can hear that Beethoven is just fascinated with the transformation, the metamorphosis of music, and of simple musical ideas especially. I hope you could hear, you know, the descriptiveness of that storm, whether you think that's outside or inside, or both. And whatever else is going on in that finale, that hymn of thanksgiving after the storm, what begins as a rustic shepherd's hymn. I don't know if you noticed, you know, the first time it came up, it was all horn calls, sort of shepherd's pipes, almost, you could imagine. But by the end of the movement, you know, this is not a simple rustic shepherd song, is it? You know, this is an ecstatic outpouring of praise, far more than a handful of shepherds. You know, this has gone way beyond Vivaldi's simple representation. It's almost as though the whole natural world is united in this hymn of praise. Imagine that. It's almost as though Beethoven has entered the world of Psalm 98, isn't it? Shout for joy to the Lord. All the earth burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn. Shout for joy before the Lord, the King. Let the sea resound and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands, let the mountains sing together for joy. It's almost as though Beethoven, in telling the story of an individual's trip to the countryside, which causes that individual to be excited, to be captivated by the natural world he sees around him, by its beauty and its magnificent power, and then concludes with his joining in, with his participating in this response of a hymn of praise, his joining in with the rest of the world. We would say the rest of creation in thanksgiving to the someone who is responsible for it all. Mm. It's almost as though Beethoven is, can't help but tell his maker's story now. This has gone way beyond simple representation. There is something much more innovative, much more fresher, newer coming here. And this is a new sound for, a new ideas for a new century. But we've got a lot more to see before we leave Beethoven behind. We've got a little bit of time. Beethoven was, by all accounts, a phenomenal pianist as well as a phenomenal composer. He left behind an incredible body of music for piano, including 32 sonatas, as well as 5 concertos for piano and orchestra. And I'd like to play you an extract now from the last of those 5 piano concerti, and this is the slow movement. It's nicknamed the Emperor. The Emperor nickname came later on. I don't think this was Beethoven's title. I don't think it even originates in Beethoven's day. So it's often referred to as the Emperor Concerto, but that's not Beethoven's title. It doesn't offend me, but just so you know. Have a listen to this. And as we've done before, just make some notes of what you hear as you listen to this. To this movement. It's fairly short, it's very beautiful. So scribble or mentally, just make notes, observations of what you can hear as you listen to the second, the slow movement, the middle movement of Beethoven's Concerto, piano concerto number 5.
find it very hard to speak after that.
Sorry. Staggering music. Any comments? Any observations? What did you notice about music? It's probably nothing too obvious. So what did you hear there?
It started with the instruments, with the strings, and the winds were added.
Good.
And then there was, the piano was interesting because it was a single note. Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
And then the whole piano was sort of simple harmonization.
Right.
Through.
Excellent.
And then the, I don't know what you call it, a tremolo?
Sorry?
Tremolo?
The trills? Yes. Yes.
Yeah, all the way through. So there was different variations in the way the piano.
Yeah.
Came through, and then there was, it ended up almost as an accompaniment to the winds at the end.
Didn't it?
So
yeah.
It kind of went through all different phases.
Right.
And so there's a transformation going on here.
Right. Mm-hmm. And the interaction of the piano and the orchestra.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fascinating. Okay, good. Very, very good. We'll come back to some of that. Any other observations? Any other?
It's so simple. The piano is so simple. Almost right. Anything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I think that's right. I mean, I think I can play those notes. I mean, I couldn't play it like Claudio Arroyo would be, you know. But yes, it's not virtuosic. You know, if you listen to the first and the third one, you know, they're the virtuoso. This is the real emotional core of the piece. And the emphasis is on lyricism now and sensitivity. Yeah, but it is very simple. It's not technically advanced. I mean, I could never play it like this gentleman here, who's one of the greatest pianists of the 20th century. But yeah, technically, it's not technically advanced. Yeah.
That first, I mean, this is not, it's more to see what it feels like it does, the very opening part of that, just when the piano comes in and it's quiet.
Right.
In me, at least, it creates almost this painful longing.
Right.
For this just beauty that's being expressed.
Okay.
I can't even quite find the words for it, but
right.
It's almost painful. It's so beautiful.
Isn't it? Yeah, yeah. And how is it prepared? What was going on before that?
Just the strings just playing chords.
Right. Yes.
It's a sort of wave. It's like a wave.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That comes up.
Right. Right. Yeah.
Like a boat.
Right. And we might have expected, you know, again, convention would say, what the orchestra plays, we might then expect the piano to play in a slightly different way. But it's completely different, isn't it? Can I just play this? I wasn't planning to, I won't play the whole thing again, but just listen to the opening.
I'm going to leave the microphone on as well.
Okay.
So that you can comment over it.
Fine. Yeah, okay. So I'm not quite sure where we are here. I think if I do this, strings only. And notice how the parts move. They all move together. Just hold that thought. This is our first tune. This is what we're expecting the piano to play when the piano enters. Thank you.
So we know the theme, we know what the piano is going to play. He's going to give us what we've just heard, right? Wrong. Completely different. Completely different. In every way.
Sorry. What key was that in?
Oh, that's a good question. That is in...
What colour is it?
Oh, it's in B major. So it's a kind of... It's a light... It's a, yes, it's a light blue. For me, it's a light blue. It's kind of a sky blue. Yeah, B major. Which in itself is very interesting because the concerto itself is in E flat. And so it's a very distant key. It has its otherworldly kind of quality about it. Let me suggest what something that's going on here, and a little program for you. This is my outline. Now, I identify six sections here in this movement. We've just listened to section one. Notice I've got a column there for voices. I think what we've got here is we've got two different voices going on here, completely different. I shouted just as section two started. That, as Marx commented, you know, that opening section, there's a topical thing going on here, if you think back to Mozart. An audience, Beethoven's audience would have recognized straight away, this is a chorale. This is in a chorale style. I shouted out, notice how all the parts move together. If you, chorale, think hymn tune, okay? If you've ever played the piano or listened in church or you've ever heard a four-part congregation sing, we essentially sing the same rhythms, don't we? And there might be four parts going. That is a chorale. And that, of course, has, we could get this perhaps a little bit more quickly than some, if we're in a church tradition, this has the character, this has the topic, this has the association of the spiritual, of the contemplative. Forgive me now if I say this. It's low voice, or it's medium low voice. It would be considered, can I say, masculine. I know that's not very politically correct, but bear me out. There is some, this first character, this first voice is all devotion, is all contemplation, is... It's low voice, you know, the flutes come in towards the end, but it's essentially something... A male voice could sing. And that's our first character before the piano enters. Notice what happens. I shouted out, you know, spoiling the beautiful music. Completely different. Now when the piano enters, we don't have chords like you might have on an organ playing in church or a four-part choir singing, you know, together. All the parts moving in the same rhythm. What do we have? It's now lyricism. It's all fantasy, it's imagination. Can I say it's, you know, notice how Beethoven really emphasizes the upper register of the piano here, the tinkling bits, for want of a better phrase. And this is very fantastic. The chords are now replaced by scales and moving about and a freedom of movement. There's a fantasy here. There's an imagination. You could almost imagine Beethoven improvising this. You know, it's just, it's got a freedom, a rhythmic freedom too. A completely contrasting character. We have the contemplative, we have the spiritual, if I can say that, the masculine in this case. And then the second character is feminine, it's lyrical, it's fantastic, it's imaginative, is high-voiced. So we have a meeting of two personalities. Now, what I find fascinating is, after that first entry of the piano, you get another chorale. We return to the character of the opening. That string section comes in again. But it's very, very brief. If you're not aware of it, you might even You might even miss it. It's not a complete restatement of section one, but it's certainly a very truncated repeat. And I, at this point, I'm starting to hear this is a conversation. This is a conversation between two characters. It's an invitation to speak again. You'll notice that the chorale, you may notice, changes key. It sets up a change of key, which then sets a platform for the piano to enter again in a different key this time. If this is a conversation, character one has spoken, he's introduced himself, shall we say. Character two has introduced himself. Now character one is saying, tell me a bit more. You know, expand on that, please. I'd like to know you better. And then we get kind of a repeat of section two and section four. We certainly have the second voice again. We have the piano voice. It's expanded now. It's longer. This is a gentlemanly conversation. He wants her to speak. He wants her to speak more and longer. The two have met. And now she speaks in a different style. Look at what I put there, amoroso. I don't know if you noticed this. Remember our countess yesterday? Spoke with the amoroso style. What were the characteristics? Do you remember? Wind instruments, clarinets, flutes, bassoons, horns, and musical thirds and musical sixths. They're all there. The first time she spoke in section two, we didn't have the amoroso style. It wasn't accompanied by the winds. But now we have the prominence of the horns, especially the outdoor instruments, remember? And the other winds and the sixths. Amoroso has come in to the conversation. Can you see where this is going? There's a certain chemistry here, if I can put it like that. And her speech concludes with these trills we mentioned earlier. Wonderfully, if I can use the word flirtatious, trills escalating up the piano. They speak to each other, they listen to each other. These are two very different characters, two very different people. Yet they complement each other. These two characters are coming together in a beautiful meeting. If this was an opera like The Marriage of Figaro, we'd be marveling at how strongly these two characters have just been set up and created and are walking off the stage in kind of three dimensions. Not a word has been spoken or sung. Obviously, this is orchestral music. Now, what happens next? This is the bit that, for me, if the performance is right, this is what destroys me. Because we get to section five, and now we get the two characters who speak together. But they don't just speak. There's a transformation going on here. There's a rhythmic transformation. They dance. There's a waltz. Listen for the three. One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. She, and what does she, the pianist, if I can say that, she takes his tune. Now that finally the piano takes the tune from section one. It's the first time the piano has played his theme. She sings his song. This is no longer a conversation, now this is a dance. The two characters are united in the dance, in the waltz. She's all lyrical, he is all compliment. You know, this is highly charged stuff, can I say? You know, if I can say this, please, you know, I think I could say this. This is beautifully erotic in the strict sense of that word, without a hint of pornographic. You know, this is highly charged and yet beautiful. And there's one more transformation to come, the final movement, the final section. Remember that tread we heard in the Countess's aria yesterday? The footsteps? The waltz gets transformed from a dance into a march. A noble march, just like we had for the Countess yesterday. They finish dancing and they walk together. And now the orchestra speaks his tune in the flute and the clarinet, while she, as Harry pointed out, weaves in an accompaniment to the texture. The two are no longer dancing, they're walking together side by side in a noble march. I think
Will you humour me? Can we listen to this again with this in mind? I would love to have... I don't think I can get that in front of us while we listen to the music. That's pretty bad. Is there some way of thinking?
I can play my... play.
Can you play it?
Another version over it, if you wish.
It may not be the right one. Yeah. Have we got that? Or I can talk us through it.
Aaron Bowen
may well be okay. He may not make us dance, but let's see.
I feel like we can see the version at some point.
Yeah. Well, okay.
We can play it and I can talk us through it. Would that help? Okay, I'll kind of show
you. Okay.
I'm
just going to leave it. I'm going to leave the microphone. And it just, it means whoever's listen to recording, it's not going to sound quite as good.
Okay.
But they'll get, we will get the perfect experience and people will wish they'd been here.
Okay. Well, I hope you've got that. And I'll try and give you some, I'll give you some clues without trying to talk too much over this divine music. Here we go. How do I do this? Do I need to go back and then pick this up? Section 1, this is Curriculum 1. Okay. It's all devotion. This would be an organ prelude in a church service, but...
Thank you.
virtuoso mood is still with us. Me to tell you that Beethoven's telling a story. Two people meet, they meet in conversation, they come together in the dance, they continue together walking side by side. It's the most beautiful and the simplest of romances. Anyone who's ever been in love resonates with the beauty of this story. It could be the story of your first disco. Wasn't mine. it could be the story of your first love. It could be the story of your whole life. My wife is the only person who's ever got me on the dance floor. My wife is the only one who's ever made me dance. It's not a story that Beethoven made up, even though he tells it with breathtaking mastery. It's a story that it's not a story fairy tales made up, even though it's a story that humanity never tires of telling, because it's the echo of the story God is telling, the ultimate story, if I could put it reverently, of boy meets girl. God's son comes to win and woo his bride. He invites her to join him in the divine conversation, to participate in the dance of the triune God, and to continue walking with him for all eternity, in a new creation. Beethoven is just like every other great storyteller. He can't help but tell his creator's story. Now there's a lot more to Beethoven's story in the whole concerto, because there's a huge first movement and third movement that we haven't even mentioned so far, but we've got a chance to watch that this evening. I think I've spoken for far too long, but any questions? Comments, thoughts.
I've known this piece really well for a long time, and it was only sitting with you in my study, whenever it was, and Jenny and you and I sitting listening to this, and you explaining this as we listened to it. I felt like it was, I think, all going from black and white to colour and 3D and mind blowing and enriching. It's not that it wasn't there before,
right?
Or I'd heard it wrongly.
No, no,
it's just enriching.
It's just a new show. Yeah,
lovely.
I mean, none of that is clever. You're not clever. I mean, I had the privilege for 13 years being paid to spend a lot of time thinking about this stuff, you know. I don't think there's anything there that you couldn't hear from yourself for yourself if you're giving enough attention and listening carefully. You know, that's not a... What I gave you yesterday was out of a book, you know. This is just from my experience and knowledge and you know, but I don't think I'm making it up. I think there's something. This is what's going on. I don't think this is just me off on a flight of fancy. There's enough hard evidence to suggest this is what Beethoven's doing.
What would you say was the end of section 5 then? Where it sort of moves from the waltz to the sort of almost andalou, I don't know what you call
that. That transformation. I don't know if I would want to pin too much on it, but there's a very sort of gentle metamorphosis going on there as the dance ends and the march begins. Technically, Beethoven has got it's a very difficult moment to negotiate. How do you go from 3 in a bar, well, it's not quite in a bar, but a feeling of 3 in a bar to 2 in a bar or 4 in a bar for a march? But there's something, thematically, there's something very interesting going on with this interweaving of the two voices again and the two characters. And I think it's, I don't know if I would want, I need to sort of think some more about it, but certainly I think the important feature is that the dance ends and the march begins. You know, they leave together, as it were, you know. They continue, they don't say goodnight, you know, they walk off into the sunset or whatever it might be, you know. Actually, I think there's something a little bit more going on, because Beethoven is very careful, and we could hear it at the end of the link there. He's very careful that the music doesn't stop and everybody cough and shuffle in the seats, and then he starts the third movement. And I'll mention a little about this tonight, just in queuing up the concert, because I think the idea of the dance, actually the idea of these two things, the four-square chorale and this fantastic dance element, you know, the fantasy and the earthy and so on, really comes together and really gets married, if I can put it like that, in the third movement, but more of that later.
In terms of representation,
yeah,
with Vivaldi, you made the comment about how he was sort of challenging us to see the meaning, because they were side by side.
Yes.
And there was a sense in which he was saying, this is what the music is representing, how judge it, kind of
thing.
But this is something different, this is interpretive, without that kind of explicit.
Absolutely.
What kind of, is this also a kind of representation, but it's there for us to discover ourselves? It's less explicit. Is it a similar type of thing, or?
I think it is. I mean, I think there are elements there, you know, that opening chorale. I think people, I mean, far later in the 19th century, whenever audiences heard that style of writing, you know, four parts essentially moving together in a hymn-like fashion, associated that with God. You know, Mahler is talking about this 100 years later, almost. So those kind of associations, the waltz would have been, I mean, we recognize a waltz from Mahler. Sadly, it's not always played as a waltz. And so then I think we've lost that. The march, even the amoroso, those topics would have been Beethoven's audience's equivalent of the saxophone and the baddie bass, and the warlike drums and so on. I mean, I've obviously elaborated on that quite a bit in telling the story. I think there's that sense in which Beethoven is inviting us to interpret, and is inviting us to trace that in the way that any artist and any poet especially, you know, just, I mean, Lindsay will
We saw that, you know, Lindsay last night was just kind of pointing us in the right direction sometimes, and she didn't spell everything out for us, did she? She just kind of turned our attention, and we all went, you know, and to kind of spell it all out as a poet would I imagine, Lindsay, if I could speak for you for a second, would almost destroy the art, wouldn't it? You know, you're writing a poem or a medical journal or whatever it might be, and so I think there's that element with the poet and with the artist in general, or the composer, of just pointing this in the right direction and then saying, okay, over to you guys to do a bit of work now. You think about this. What do you think is going on? And of course, that's part of the exquisite, there's that word again, Lindsay Gaines, the exquisite joy of art. You know, there's also the discovery as we participate in it as an audience.
Can I say something really controversial? No, it's not controversial. It might be provocative and controversial. Which is to take what you just said about Lindsay's poetry and to take what you're saying about music and to say that there are large chunks of scripture that are in those forms rather than the medical textbook forms.
Right.
There you go.
I'm just going to ask you to expand on the first. I think I know what you mean.
If you went to Lindsay's poetry or to this music with a particular sort of medical textbook type of grid,
right,
you'll miss most of what's going on.
Right. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. And so you're thinking of passages such
as... Yeah, I think... I mean, obviously the Psalms are all poetry.
Mm-hmm.
Large chunks of scripture written phenomenologically, rather than necessarily just propositionally. Mm. That's not to say they don't make truth claims; they most certainly do.
Mm.
But just if we don't recognize the genre of what we're reading, what we're hearing, and we try and interpret it as though it's something else, we might miss it. And in one sense, what you're doing here is you're showing us how to listen well.
Right.
And we might map similar ideas onto how to read well, listen well to text as well.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. And
it's just a passing thought, really.
Yeah, no, that's helpful. Just as you were talking, I remember when I was in Bible college, our Old Testament lecture, going through wisdom literature with us and dealing with Proverbs. The danger with Proverbs is, of course, you read them as promises.
Mm.
So teach your child the way to go, and always, I can't remember the correct wording, but essentially,
if your child goes wrong, it's because you've made a mess.
Well, that's how we read it, isn't it? You know, if my child grows up and doesn't, follow the Lord, I must have done something wrong because there's that promise. And of course, the Proverbs don't work like that. They are generally true, but you nail it down to every individual example, you're going to end up with problems. And I remember him saying, there's that very mysterious one. Three things I don't understand, four things that are too great for me.
Mm-hmm.
I can't remember the order, but the way of the snake on a rock, the eagle in the sky, is it a boat on the water, and the way of a young man. And he leaves it. And what is that? That is, unless you're a genius, you go, oh, yeah, well, I know what that's talking about. I think there's an invitation there to say, go away, think about that for half an hour. It might be half an hour well spent. And so the genre, it's poetry, isn't it? It's an invitation for contemplation and to turn your phone off, to turn the telly off, to whatever else you're doing, and think about it. Imagine that, And that's in scripture, so that's very helpful. That awareness of what kind of literature we're reading, even within the covers of one book and God's word. That's very helpful.
I'm interested in pushing back on the sort of modernist view of meaning and how meaning can speak about.
Yeah.
What would you sort of say to someone who wants to argue that the meaning is in the topic alone, and since the topic is constructed by us, that we are then just constructing and projecting meaning
as opposed to what I understand you to be saying, which is that the talk is being used to convey a meaning that you want to put across.
Yeah.
And
like, that's a
can you talk a bit about that?
Yeah, that was a really helpful question.
Thank you. I think what I would want to go with is almost put it back on the modern or the postmodern idea, which is such an obsession with contextualization. And it's true, of course, that we can't inhabit the world of 1811 totally, but from what we can gather from that, you know, and what we can have a partial knowledge of the world of 1811. And all the evidence from that would suggest that Beethoven and Mozart, we use that example yesterday, is writing in such a way that they're using these things as part of a bigger picture. They want to point us in a certain direction. They want to invite us here. And so it's, you know, as I said, there is, of course, a culture. You've got to learn these associations. Topic doesn't work in a foreign culture, or doesn't work immediately in a foreign culture, maybe. But that's a given, as far as they're concerned. You know, Beethoven is writing for an audience in Vienna who he could expect to know these things. And he expects that to have an effect, an impact. But that's why he does it, and that's why Mozart did it, was to convey those things. Does that make sense? Does that answer the question?
Yeah. I'm not quite sure if it does,
but I think that's where I would want to go with it, would be, hey, as a culture, we love contextualization. Well, let's be consistent then. Let's do that. And let's try and, with our partial knowledge, admittedly only partial, examine how they thought about music. And that, in a way, is what I'm trying to do this week. It's sort of pushing back with Stravinsky. So.
Makes you wonder if Stravinsky ever listened to that.
I mean, you know, I don't want to make Stravinsky out to be a buffoon. You know, I mean, that would be...
It's going to be interesting to think about the wider history in your next few sessions, which take us more or less from here to Stravinsky and beyond, right?
Yeah, yeah.
What happens
right. In
the world of ideas, mm-hmm. in history, in politics, in culture,
right.
in art?
Yeah.
In the 100 years between this
right.
and Rite of Spring.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah. That's actually going to be really helpful for us to track that.
Yes.
And then follow that trajectory through to the present and say, you know, what are some of the reactions and overreactions? The babies that get thrown out with bathwater.
Yeah.
What are some of the things that are rightly being reacted against?
Mm-hmm.
So those kind of questions would be the ones that are sort of bouncing around my head as we're moving forward.
Great. And one of the real advantages of something like this is you've got expertise in literature, history, social sciences, you know, that I don't have, you know, and of course this is why this is such a great opportunity, because you can say, there's huge gaps in my knowledge, you know, but of course, politically, this was going on, oh, really, right, you know, and I would welcome those kind of, you know, contributions as you have them, so.
Yeah. I mean, it's one of the political things that follows through Beethoven's career is Beethoven and Napoleon.
Mm-hmm.
Because Beethoven initially idolizes Napoleon, and then is thoroughly disillusioned with him. Right?
Yeah, Napoleon declares himself emperor of France. Mm-hmm. Beethoven scores his name off the front of the Third Symphony, which was originally called Bonaparte. And the manuscript survived. You know, you can see it's born out of venom, you know, and it's renamed heroic. But yeah, I mean, that quote, you know, that I had, where it was, you know, that's pure Napoleon in a way. It's, there is only one Beethoven, you know, that is in spirit with it, at the age of Bonaparte and the revolution and the individual. You know, we do see the beginnings of romanticism and even very early beginnings, arguably, of modernism. It's kind of,
there's an utter self-confidence in that quotation. That is also expressed in the music.
Yeah.
It's utterly self-confident. And
yeah.
I read a biography of Beethoven recently, and one of the things I hadn't realised was they would have these, basically, you know, it sounded a bit like what X Factor would be like. You know, with the, or The Voice or something like that. Where people are, you know, who's the best singer? And they would have these competitions. Who's the best piano? Who can shred best on the piano? who can? And it was all about improvisation.
Yes.
And Beethoven beat everybody.
Yeah.
He was apparently just extraordinary.
Yeah.
Just out of this world by all accounts. You know, he'd be like the guy who could pick up the guitar and do anything with it.
Yeah.
And have people, you know, whistling and cheering and all that kind of stuff. And then to be
right
that superhero
who
goes deaf.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
It's a tragic.
Oh, yeah.
It's like Freddie Mercury of the day.
Kind of. I mean, a personality like that, you know, must have been, just a bull in a china shop socially and a force of nature. Anyway, I could go on about that.
So just wondering, when they're composing, would they tend to compose each individual like musical section, so like the strings, would they compose them separately and do like the whole sonata in one go, or would they write them section by section, instrument by instrument?
That's a really good question. I mean, it's hard to know sometimes. There's a lot of Beethoven sketches, so I referred to the sketches of those symphonies earlier, and those sketchbooks survive, and you'll see he's just scribbling ideas, rhythmic and melodic ideas, and ideas from the Fifth Symphony and the Sixth Symphony and other works are all appearing together. So he's obviously just mulling stuff over, and he's had an idea, right, you know, I want to remember that one first, and then that goes down in the corner. So there's a lot of stuff going on in his head. Mozart, for example, there's very few sketches, and traditionally people have thought Mozart just had all his stuff planned up here, and then just all came out. Some people are now starting to question that. Some people are starting to say, "Ah, Mozart just burned his sketches." You know, who knows? But probably a bit of both. And then I think once he got to actually sit down and write, I think Beethoven would fill his page with a line for every part of the orchestra and just write it out. Other composers would kind of write at the piano, so and then would orchestrate later. So would almost write a piano piece and then decide, okay, how am I going to set this for orchestra? But I don't think there's any evidence of Beethoven and Mozart did that. I think the Romantics may have done that later, where that whole art of orchestration became almost like a portrait of a landscape. So probably a mixture of things, sketching, scribbling, and then also a real sense of, okay, here's my canvas now. I'm just going to write for the whole orchestra.
There's a wonderful story of Beethoven wandering through this rural scenery. In tears.
Right.
Because he is moved by the piece of music that he's composing in his head.
Right.
And he's hearing this thing in his head.
Right.
And he's so moved by this. I think it was maybe these 14th string quartet, one of those later string quartets.
Yes.
They're so poignant.
Yeah.
And he's walking along, and it's just in his head, he's imagining it, and he's in tears. Yeah. Which I think is just bonkers.
Yeah. I mean, again, it's that sort of culture that we're dealing with. I mean, your biblical scholars tell me, you know, in Bible times, people's memory was phenomenal. You know, different time, different culture, you know, people would be able to recite huge chunks of the Psalms of the Old Testament. And again, you know, for these guys, we're lazy. You know, if we want to listen to this, you know, we don't even put a CD on, do we? We just click an app or something now. And, you know, we haven't even got to do a physical act at all, really, apart from boom. Whereas, you know, if you wanted to hear music, you had to go to a concert. If you want to hear an orchestra, you'd have to go to a concert and hear it. Or you had to hear it in the end. And so, you know, these were great minds. But their minds were trained to retain in the way that people in Bible times, their minds were trained to retain. With our immediate sort of information age, we don't retain anything. You know, how many folders? I don't know my own.
We've subcontracted our memory to Google.
Right. When I was a kid, I knew 6 phone numbers. You know, because we were using landlines. You know, I knew how to phone home, and I knew my best mate, and I knew my brothers. You know, I don't have 1 phone number anymore.
Except for those 6.
I can still remember my own one. Let's see what I can remember. Anyway, that's...
Should I stop recording it?
Yeah.